how to integrate the shadow. I mean, I guess what I'd start with is what the shadow is, and then talk about how you integrate, and I would start with basically just letting you know that, you know, it's a lifelong process. Ultimately, because we live in duality, where everything has a pole, a positive and a negative, there's no way to really get rid of the shadow altogether. So it's a lifelong process, and that's what Jung talked about as far as bringing the unconscious, making it conscious. That's the same as bringing the shadow into the light, right? And so from a Jungian perspective, he sort of broke the psyche up into four archetypes, one being the ego, the other being the shadow, and those two come together and make a whole, right? And so the thing that we pay attention to, we bring into the light, and then we naturally, if we're not conscious, our ego, we will take what we're not conscious of and push it into the shadow. And that's basically ultimately what the shadow is. It's what we're denying. You know, it's what we're repressing. It's what we don't want to, we don't like about ourselves or others, or, and that's one aspect of the shadow. There's other aspects of the shadow which aren't things that are repressed. They're just things that haven't emerged from our natural psyche yet. So there's two parts. Like Jung talked about the personal unconscious and the collective unconscious. And he also talked about the unconscious, and there's like three levels, and they just get deeper and deeper. So the personal unconscious is the stuff that is repressed and denied about your psyche. And the collective unconscious would be things that are not, they're new. And so the shadow isn't always negative. You know, we can repress a lot of things or allow for things that we just don't know yet about ourselves. We would also call that the shadow. So it's kind of a broad term that Jung talked about. The other two archetypes that I want to bring up that I mentioned earlier, there were four, is the persona and the soul. And so there, I sort of put them on a, there's the vertical axis, which is about your identity, who I am and who I am not. And then the horizontal axis, which is the face you turn to the external world and the face you turn to the internal world. And so that's relational axis. So there's the identity axis and the relational axis. And those are the four main archetypes of Jungian psychology, where shadow is one aspect of that.
So can you access the collective unconscious in dreams?
Absolutely. Yeah, and dreams is a good place to actually, I'm going to go back to your question and I'll answer that one in a second, because I think the integration of the shadow is what you do with your dreams. Your dreams will reveal to you, you know, things that you don't know about yourself, and that's how you get to know your shadow. Another way to get to know your shadow is projection. And we think that, the common thinking around projection is that it's bad. Well, no, actually, it's only bad if you don't take back your projection, but the only way the unconscious can manifest is to literally come up out of you and project somewhere, like on a screen, right? And so projection is the only way, and dreams are the other way. Now, when you're looking at dreams, you know, you can look at dreams and see that there's personal material in the dream. Oh, that's really just all about your complexes or ego or your shadow or whatever. But then there can be big dreams, we call them, that are symbolic or either running storylines that are, you know, like a Cinderella storyline is a common woman's dream, you know. And so then that's where you sort of get into the collective unconscious aspect, where there are storylines that everybody's running all the time.
So to get back to integrating the shadow, you said in order to bring up the subconscious, you can do that in two ways. One is through dreams and dream work, and the other is projection. So how... Right. Like, for as an example, what's a good way to see your projection? Is it through relationships?
It's always through relationships.
Okay.
It's almost always through relationships. You can identify that you're dealing with shadow material most of the time when you get emotionally charged by something. You're like, I don't like that about that person, right? Well, more than likely, it's something about yourself that you're not admitting that you don't like about yourself. It's not going to charge you, if it's not about you.
Right.
You know, that's really the truth. You know, when we get charged about other people, it's really 90% about us,
mm-hmm.
you know, about something I'm still trying to hide, or maybe they're getting away with it and I want to get away with it, you know, and I can't get away with it, you know. Yeah, right?
How interesting. Right. I never thought about it that way.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm thinking as a day-to-day exercise to become very much more aware of projections and understanding
right.
your own individual psyche.
That's
like
right.
is it about paying attention to your emotions, like daily or hourly or
all the time?
All the time.
The emotions are our indicator of it's the number one indicator of what's going on in your psyche. I mean, the emotions are the center of a complex. A complex is a term that Jung used to describe when we're basically in the unconscious projecting. He called that whole sort of process the complex. And it's always, it always starts with an emotion. So you're emotionally charged by something. And when that happens in the mind sort of creates this sort of electrical magnetic field in the mind itself. That then starts attracting all these old scripts and ideas and beliefs and thoughts and, you know, and they just start spinning stories, right?
Yeah.
And so if you can watch all that, then you can learn your psyche really quickly. Yeah.
The key is to watch.
The key is to watch that.
The observer.
Right.
Because because if you have an emotion that's, let's say it's a charge, but you feel like it's a negative charge, you
mm-hmm.
feel like a negative connotation to the emotion, it's not necessarily negative, it's just telling you something to be aware of, right?
Correct.
To look at why you feel that way.
Correct. Yeah. There's a lot of different ways to go with this. I mean, if we didn't have a repressed unconscious, if we didn't have a shadow, then most of that emotional charge would be telling us stuff about our environment. And so when I first start working with people, I don't tell them about that last part because realistically what's really going on is it's all about their shadow and it's about their own psyche. And so what I tell people is that the first place to look when you're emotionally charged is your own psyche. You know, what is going on? Is this, am I being reminded of my brother, my sister, my mother, my father, my, you know, uncle, my aunt, you know, all of those family patterns are in our psyche and they get activated by other people. And then you can go, whoa, wait a minute here. I've just painted this other person with the imago, the image of my mother or my father or whatever. And so in that moment, you take that back and then you have a fresh look at this other person because they're not your mother. They're just a trigger for your mother or your father or whatever.
I love the way you said that. You take it back.
Take it back.
So you're allowing yourself to be integrated.
Mm, right.
And then you're allowing that other person to be them.
Right.
And then you're not you're a little bit more whole. You're not a victim of that
correct.
Circumstance anymore. And you're
right.
holding responsibility for your own emotion. And
that's
space.
Exactly right. And that's really the only way to do it because otherwise you are it, you know. And so what we're trying to do with consciousness is to go from being an I to a me. So when I go from an I to a me, I can observe myself and I can make changes. But if I'm the I itself, I don't know the I that I'm identifying with right now. I only know the I that I identified after the fact, right? Or if I've got like really high, you know, sort of meditation and I can just watch myself in every second, which I can't do, but I know monks that can't do it either.
Right.
So we're after the fact observing ourselves going, and that's what self-reflection is about, is really going, what did I just do? What did I just say? Why did I think that? What was going on? And like I said, almost all of it is about your own psyche. You know, and in those moments when we can sort of take back whatever we've projected, we have these, you know, we have the opportunity to truly meet someone. But at the moment that we go, I already know that person, you don't know them. All you know is your own psyche.
Mm.
You know, we haven't really given them an opportunity to show up in their unique, you know, differences.
Right. And discover even something that you don't know.
Right.
About yourself, even. You're denying that chance.
Exactly.
Even.
And that's what we mean about being present, because that's the other thing that's really critical about, you know, is you have to be present. You have to be present and alert. And in those ways, that's how you begin to get to know your psyche and go, wow, well, this is going on. Emotion just went through me. What just triggered that? You know, oh, okay. Or emotion is going through me. I'm not going to let it manifest. I'm just going to go, it goes through, boom. Okay. I'm back. You know, cause sometimes we take, especially as women, we take our emotions so seriously and really, you know, we should take the emotions seriously. But maybe not in that moment we need to do that. And we certainly don't want to be reactive to emotions, right? We want to be conscious of the emotions, but not taken by the emotions. Every single time we're taken by emotion, we are acting out unconsciously. We are acting out our shadow, you know, to get back to the shadow. If we are in our emotion and we are acting out a shadow projection, a shadow movie. It is not what's really going on.
So let's break it down. So it's important to be aware of the emotion and let it pass through.
Correct.
Without the reaction. It's just an indicator of something that's happened in the past.
Right.
So instead of reacting, you let it pass through. So what are kind of activities that or actions that you can take in order to be present and not allow the reaction to come out and to just be the observer?
Yeah, I think it depends on whether it's a quick emotion or it's a lasting emotion that goes into a mood. And so I try to make a distinction between an emotion that's still just in the psyche versus an emotion that's really in the body. And it becomes part of your biology. Because I know for my own case, sometimes when an emotion comes through me and it's really deep and it's really like, oh my God, that's shaking my whole body, it could take a long time for that to pass, you know, hours really for that to pass. And what I do is music. Music is the number one thing to change a mood, to change an emotion, you know, and so that's the number one thing. But also just movement in general, like getting on your bike or going for a walk or whatever you like, yoga, you know, that would help more so than meditation. I don't know that meditation would help as much when you're going through an emotional aspect.
Right. Meditation is kind of a practice that helps you kind of get you ready for the emotion instead of expel the emotion.
Yeah, meditation is a practice. I like exactly what you said there. It's a practice. We do it so that we can stay alert and aware and have more opportunities of staying alert and aware. So it's a practice just like you would go to the gym to exercise your muscles. That's what meditation really is. So you can stay alert and be present. Because you can't do any psychological work unless you're alert and you're present. If you don't have those two things, then you're not actually doing any, you know, psychological work.
So it's two things. It's meditation to stay present, that as a practice.
Right.
And then the alertness comes from being aware. So
aware,
it's
observing. Yes.
Asking yourself those questions.
Right.
Stepping outside of yourself.
Right.
That as a practice.
Yeah. And the other thing I would say too is really important, and this is what I try to do with my clients, and that is to teach them about psyche. Because it's one thing to be present and aware. But what are you aware of, right? And so if you don't know the pieces of your psyche and you don't know this is a projection or this is a shadow or this is whatever, then you don't know what you need to be aware of. And it's just like, you know, it's just like this blob of stuff, yeah. Right? And so if you start to have a language around, you know, what is going on in my head here, and then you can point them out and then you can see it, then you know what to be aware of.
So what are some of the tools that you use to help teach the language of the psyche or to help someone learn about their own psyche?
I have like three or four different things that I use to help people begin to understand their psyche. I start with the Myers-Briggs type indicator, which is a Jungian tool that Myers-Briggs picked up and added things to, which gives a person a perspective of their of their psychological type, whether they're an introvert or an extrovert, whether they perceive the world through their senses or through intuition, whether they judge the world as a thinker through logic or as a feeler through how people feel about things, or what the relationships are going to be affected by this judgment. And then the last letter of the Myers-Briggs is about how they orient to the world. Do they like to perceive, or do they like to judge? And so I do that because it helps a person get a sense of who they are and what their types are, because we too often come into psychology or a psychologist's office thinking, I have to be normal. Well, there is no normal, right? That's like, you know, the 60s or the 70s idea of psychology. Normal is, what is your type and who are you? So that's the first thing I do, is I help them understand how they perceive and judge the world and what their orientations are to the world. Then I take them into astrology, and what that helps is to understand what conflicts are they meant to deal with in this lifetime. And so astrology shows, the natal chart will show what they were born with, what are the conflicts, what are the, you know, the good things, and so on, that will help them. It helps me understand, you know, their soul, basically, what their soul is and their soul journey. And, you know, what lessons are they meant to learn in this lifetime. It helps me understand, like, career, relationships, home, all kinds of different things you can get out of the natal chart of astrology. The other thing that I do sometimes is the transit chart, which is where are the stars now in relationship to the stars when you were born, or the planets when you were born. And that helps to understand what's being activated now, you know. Mm-hmm. And so you have, like, you know, and it's generational. So, like, when a person's like 28 to 29 years old, they're going through Saturn return. And it's the first time in their life that Saturn went all the way around the chart, and they've laid down the first pattern of their life. And so the next sort of 28 and a half years is going to look a little like the first 28 years. So they get a sense of what that pattern was. It was just laid down. And then like about age 35 to 42, you get a lot of outer planet transits that start activating all kinds. That's what midlife is all about. It starts activating all kinds of spiritual things, transformation, change things, relational things, career things. They all get activated with those outer planet transits. And so it helps me understand the natal chart, and then what's being activated in that natal chart and when. And then the other tool that I use is the Enneagram. And I like the Enneagram because it gives you a sense of what your personality is, but you're not your personality. And so it gives you a way to sort of get also in touch with the soul. Like, here's how my personality structured. I'm a 4 on the Enneagram. What does that mean? Well, and then I basically go, and you're not that. That's just the way your ego formed. You know, you're deeper than that. You're something else than that. And so this is another one of those things where you don't want to be an I, you want to see it as a me. That's how my ego functions. That's how my personality is structured, but that's not who I am. And so that's really, really a deep, good spiritual tool that helps with that.
So what would you say to someone who asks you, why do you need to integrate your shadow?
I think the people that want to integrate their shadow are people that already are aware of the fact that they're suffering in some way, you know, and mostly they're suffering because of relationship, and their relationships are going through the same patterns over and over and over again, and they don't know why. And more than likely, what's happening is the shadow's getting in the way. There's some part of themselves that, as I said earlier, that being something from their own unconscious is being projected on their relationship, and they're with the same type of guy over and over and over again. And they will be, because their psyche is set up to attract that type of guy until they work that shadow part out, and they don't attract that same person.
So you can create something new.
Well, yeah, otherwise you're kind of a unconscious automaton if you don't work your shadow. I hate to be so crass, but yeah, you really are. And there's a lot, we see it everywhere we go, where we see people just sort of making, you know, the girlfriend calls and says, la 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 la, and you're like, oh, there she goes again. Same old story, right? And what we're really, you know, what we're really seeing and witnessing is that we've got to wake up. Otherwise, we're just going to continue suffering. And that's it. I mean, that's it. And that's the people that come to a psychologist almost always. It's because they're suffering somehow emotionally and almost always relationally. And the shadow is the critical element in all of that.
It's, and could you like even simplify it by saying it's, you're not fully integrating all of yourself.
Yeah, you're not being whole. Yeah.
So the suffering is because you're not whole.
Exactly. I would totally say that your suffering is because you're not whole. Yeah, definitely.
And you said this is a lifetime process, so you're always going to be integrating.
Yeah, you don't always need to be with a psychologist. A good psychologist will teach you how to do it. Yeah. Right, so you can do it on your own, you know. Mm. You don't do the fishing, you teach how to fish, right? And so but it is a lifetime process, and I think it has its peaks and valleys. I mean, you know, the more intense something is going on in your life, more intense a new relationship is or whatever, you're going to have a lot of shadows going to show up. And then if you have like these periods where you're just sort of floating along, you know, maybe you don't have to do a lot of shadow work then, you know. So there are peaks and valleys to the shadow work. And the astrology chart will definitely show, you know, why something's getting activated in your chart with Mars or Pluto or whatever is going on at that time.
I'm talking about the collective unconscious. Do you think that there's, as a whole, like a shadow of different countries? Like as
oh gosh,
a whole?
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm. I would say the shadow of the United States, I would go right to Christianity when I describe the psyche of the United States. And then I would look at what the shadow is of Christianity, because of all the countries, Christian countries, America is probably the most Christian. One of the things that I really liked about Jung's work with regards to his analysis of Christianity is that he understood that part of the problem is that it didn't integrate its shadow, and that it's like all light, you know, all benevolent God, and we're like these moral, like, you know, righteous beings, which is completely not true. And so we in America are constantly at war and conflict with someone that is our enemy. And so, like now in the Middle East, you know, or the Muslims for now, you know, it's part of the Christian psyche not to integrate the shadow and to project it out there. And at some point we got to wake up. We've got to stop doing that. And we've got to realize that that's just a projection of the Christian psyche. I like to look at the psyche both as a noun and a verb. And we too much overemphasize nouns. So even when we talk about the shadow, it's a person or it's an entity, but it has too much of a noun feel to it. And we're really much more verbs than we are nouns. And that's if we're really trying to, you know, be in the flow of what's the truth of our reality and our psyche, it is moving. It's moving. And so what does that mean? What is a shadow from a verb perspective? And that's when I like to look at things, I like to break things down in between what's creative and what's destructive. And so when in the dual world that we live in, at every single moment, there's an act of creation, there is an equal and opposite act of destruction. And so that would be the shadow in that thinking, right? The destructive element that goes along with the creative element, you know. And so, for instance, and this is what I often use as an example, silence. At the moment that I speak, I've just destroyed silence, right? And so there's creation, my speaking, and there's destruction, the loss of silence. And so if you look at everything, you can begin to see what's creative and what's destructive. And so in that regard, if you're creative, if you're a creative person, if you're creative, if that's your career, then my advice is always to be aware that there's going to be a destructive repercussion of that, and to have healthy destructive practices in your life. And they don't have to be like going off destroying things. You can just go running like, or you can punch a bag, or you do karate, or you do something that's going to get that sort of aggressive destructive energy out, because it comes with the act of creation, period.
You know, I haven't really thought about it like that, but that's also part of America's shadow as well, because we are perhaps the most creative nation on this planet. We have the most innovations, the most creative people, but we also have the darkest shadow with our war and our the way that we treat other countries, and they go together. That destruction and that creation, it goes together.
So to kind of sum it up, basically, is to, yes, be these creative beings that we are, and let that beauty shine, but also know that we live in this duality and that destruction will come up, but to choose to let it out through healthy expressions.
Yeah, exactly. To know it's there and to funnel it into creative destruction. I don't know if there's
healthy, healthy destruction, where you're not hurting others or yourself. I mean, that's really how I define it. You don't want to be self-destructive. That's the masochistic personality. And you don't want to be other-destructive, the sadistic. You want to know, oh, I got to get this energy out. And that's why exercise is so important. And like I said, some of the martial arts are really important for that. Kickboxing or stuff like that.
Right. Could you even put it into your creative process, like writing? Or is that not really integrating the whole body as much as exercise?
No, I think maybe that's a brilliant way to work it, because if you're dealing with the darker energies in your creative process, you're doing both. Are doing both, you know, so you're giving life to sort of this darker part, and I think you're doing both.
As an artist, I think that would be, I think so far, that's one of my favorite ways to do it, because that's where you get the truth and that's what you want to share anyways.
Yeah.
Integrating your shadow. Letting others integrate their shadow as well.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I guess the last thing I'll say about that is your dreams are a good place also if you work them where some of the destructive energy can come out, right? So... Mm-hmm. If you've spent all day doing something beautiful and creative, and then you like went to bed that night, and all of a sudden you're like killing people or something, there you go. It's working out the destructive energy that goes along with creation. That's also a way the psyche works, is that the dreams sort of complement what goes on in the daylight, the nightlight, you know. And so that's the other thing. You put them together, and you have a whole.
That's great. Just to really write down your dreams and pick up the symbols, work them.
Yeah.
That'll be our next topic.
Oh, maybe. Perfect. I would love that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks so much.
All right. Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome.